Hello and welcome to Southern Cross Station in Melbourne. A lot of you have asked me to do an Overland review, so today I'm going to catch this train from Melbourne all the way to Adelaide, South Australia, in its red premium class. Let's go!
The Overland is a passenger train service between Melbourne and Adelaide, a distance of 828 kilometres and a total journey time of 10 hours and 30 minutes. It first ran in 1887 as the Adelaide Express, and it's now operated by private company Journey Beyond, the same company that runs Indian Pacific, the GAN and Great Southern luxury trains in Australia. The Overland currently undertakes two return trips each week. The luggage hall is situated on the Bourke Street Bridge, the corridor between the platforms and the coach terminal. Journey Beyond's website says that for the Overland service, the luggage hall opens 1 hour prior to departure. But when I was there 90 minutes before departure, it was already staffed. The luggage hall is for you to check in your suitcase. If you only have a carry-on bag, you can head straight to the platform. The Overland normally uses platform 2 at Southern Cross Station. While on the platform, I was approached by one of the Journey Beyond staff to check me in. I was asked if I had been in a COVID-19 hotspot, if I had any COVID symptoms, and if I had filled out the SA boarder pass. After satisfying all the questions, I was allocated a seat and was given this boarding pass. I'm now ready to go. Woohoo! The locomotive that will be hauling the Overland today is Pacific National NR10. It is a standard gauge diesel-electric locomotive with a maximum speed of 115 km per hour. The NR class were the first locomotives in Australia to have variable horsepower, which meant that the power output of the engine had three different settings, making the NR class the most fuel-efficient locomotives in Australia. Today, the Overland consists of six cars. Car A and B are fitted with red premium class seats. Car C is a lounge car. Car D and E are fitted with red standard class seats. And the final car is a power van. The carriages were built between 1950 and 1972. They were specifically built for the Overland train service. Around 44 carriages were built, and these six are the only remaining cars that are still being used for the Overland service. The tracks on platform 1 and platform 2 are dual gauge track, allowing both standard gauge interstate trains and broad gauge V-line trains to operate at this station. Boarding commenced approximately 40 minutes before departure. First, let me show you the red standard class seats. The seats are in a 2-2 configuration with a total of 15 rows, 60 seats per carriage. The seats have generous legroom. There's a tray table stored in the armrest. Each seat is reclinable. There's an overhead luggage rack on either side of the train and an individually controlled reading light above each seat. A wheelchair accessible toilet is located at the back of the carriage. The luggage allowance for red standard class is 2 × 20 kg. Between red standard and red premium carriage is a licensed cafe A28. It has several dining tables and sells meals and beverages throughout the journey. I'll come back to this carriage a bit later. Finally, this is my red premium carriage, car B. The red premium class has 12 rows, 36 seats in each carriage. The seats are in a 2-1 configuration. With 3 fewer rows than red standard, I believe the legroom is 20% greater. Like red standard, there's a toilet at the back of the car. To lock, you have to push the green button first, then push the red one after the door is fully closed. The facilities in the toilet include a sink, a needle disposal box, a hand wash dispenser, a paper towel dispenser, a hand dryer, a sanitary bin, and a baby changing station.
Traveling premium, breakfast and lunch.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, we are moving. Yes, hello.
So in a while, we'll come along and take orders.
Other than that, sit back, relax, and enjoy this lovely little drive today.
Good morning, everyone. Hello, my name is Megan. Welcome to the train today. So we've just handed out your menus. Your breakfast and lunch is already included in your ticket price, so you do not have to pay.
Yay.
The curry of the day is a buffalo musaman curry. It's a gluten-free curry. Now, if you lift up your armrests, there's a tray table in all of your armrests. Have a practice when you've got a moment getting that out, because when I come through shortly with your cutlery, if you could have the table out ready for us, that would be great.
Now let's have a closer look at the seat. Approximately 50% of the window seats in Red Premium have unobstructed window view, whereas the other half have views partially blocked by the wall. I was very fortunate to be assigned, in my opinion, the best seat on this train. The window ledge is big enough that you can rest your arm or place small items such as your phone there. Again, the legroom is really great. Each seat is reclinable and the headrest is fully covered by leather. The seat width is the same as the Red Standard seat. There's a pocket at the back of each seat and a retractable tray table in the armrest. The table is very stable. Journey Beyond provides a footrest upon request. Above the seats, there are also overhead luggage racks and reading lights. The luggage allowance for Red Premium is 2 × 30 kilos. Breakfast, lunch, afternoon tea, coffee, soft drinks and juice are included in the Red Premium ticket. The staff handed out the menu and took our breakfast and lunch order shortly after the train left Melbourne. The choices for breakfast were omelette or yogurt parfait.
What would you like?
Can I get you omelette?
Yes.
The curry, please.
Okay, Mark will get your drink in a moment. What would you like?
Hello. Thank you.
After leaving Southern Cross Station, the train runs on the Western Standard Gauge line. The line was converted to Standard Gauge in 1995. The train travelled quite slowly while in Melbourne metropolitan area. It took us 15 minutes to travel to Werribee.
No bacon. 28, were you having bacon? No.
The meals on this train are cooked fresh by an onboard chef. My omelette was plated beautifully. It looked very appetizing. The bacon was crispy, the house-made baked beans had a hint of tomato, which was a perfect match with the omelette. The slice of sourdough was just warm enough to melt the butter, the portion of the dish was also right on point, not too much, not too little. I'm sorry that I'm not a food critic, I don't have all the fancy words to describe a dish. All you need to know is that I was very satisfied with the breakfast. This station is Werribee, located 31.7 kilometers from Southern Cross. It is the terminus of the electrified Werribee line and the end of Melbourne suburban rail network. From now on, the train for most of the time runs at its top speed, 115 kilometers per hour.
Ladies and gentlemen, in around about 10 minutes we'll be at our first stop, which is North Shore Geelong. North Shore Geelong is the largest regional town in Victoria and has a population of over 260,000 people. The name Geelong was given to the town in 1937 by Governor Richard Burke. The post office opened on the 27th of August 1898. It was known as Corio from 1908 to 1913 before reverting to North Shore. Geelong is not only an industrial area, it is also residential and has a magnificent waterfront area full of retail, hospitality, tourism and businesses. We can't forget Geelong's passion for Aussie rules football and their beloved cats.
After North Shore Geelong, the train headed west towards Ararat via Cressy. Now, let's have a look at the cafe 828 carriage. Do you know where the number 828 came from? Yes, that's the distance between Melbourne and Adelaide. Throughout the day, the cafe sells all sorts of hot and cold snacks, desserts, and even the Overland merchandise. I couldn't find a menu that includes everything that they sell. Here's a list of meals which are included in Red Premium Ticket and can be purchased by passengers in Red Standard Class. I bought a carton of chocolate milk for $4.50 and found an empty table to sit down and relax. I found several power plugs here in the cafe. If you need to charge your device, you know where to find the plugs now. Let's talk a little bit about the history of the Overland train. The train first ran in 1887. It is the oldest continuously operating passenger train in Australia. A snapshot of the service in November 1990 included a car carrier, two sleepers, a club car, another two sleepers, a first, second buffet, second seating cars, and a luggage van. In holiday seasons, the train was regularly built up to 16 carriages. However, the service gradually reduced from 5 daytime and 2 night journeys per week in each direction in 1998 to 2 daytime services per week in each direction today.
We have made up some fresh sandwiches today. There are two varieties that we've made up, a turkey, lettuce and cranberry, or there's a ham, cheese and pickle. You can have those fresh or you can have them toasted also.
Without the Victorian government subsidising the service, the Overland would have ceased operations in 2018. The trip from North Shore Geelong to Ararat took exactly 2 hours. When you can see the Grampians in the distance, you know Ararat is not too far away.
This attractive old gold mining town was established in 1857. The only Australian town to have been founded by the Chinese people. With a population of around 12,000, it is the commercial centre for an agricultural region producing wheat, oats, fine wool and wine.
Ararat station has two platforms, one full-length standard gauge platform and one broad gauge bay platform. The station is the terminus of V-Line Ararat railway line, which is served by broad gauge velocity train to Melbourne via Ballarat several times a day. Following Ararat is Stawell. It's about 25 minutes to the northwest.
The Grampians National Park and to its tourist village of Hall's Gap, which makes it an ideal base from which to explore the natural attractions in the area. Stawell is also home to Australia's oldest and richest foot race, the Stawell Gift, which is held on an oval every Easter, just behind the train station on the right. Now folks, to my knowledge, I don't have anyone to pick up or drop off at Stawell. If you do intend on getting off at Stawell, please come down to the cafe car and let me know straight away. Otherwise, the drivers will go through the station really slowly. If there is somebody waiting there, we'll stop. Otherwise, we'll make our way through to Horsham.
The staff began to serve lunch when the train left Stawell. The two-course lunch had three main meal options. I found the curry of the day to be the most popular dish among passengers, so I ordered the curry too. A complimentary soft drink, tea, coffee, juice or water was included. There were also alcoholic beverages available for purchase. The curry of the day was buffalo massaman curry. The massaman curry is a southern Thailand cuisine, characterized by its tasty curry and its coconut milk-based soup. However, massaman is not a Thai word, it refers to Muslim. That's because the flavors were originally brought by Muslim traders from Indian subcontinent and Malay archipelago. Basically, if you take Indian curry spices and do a mashup with aromatics used in Thai cuisines, then add coconut and peanuts, you will end up with massaman curry. From the presentation of this dish, I believe it was cooked correctly. The massaman curry is a thick sauce with mild, slightly sweet flavor, so even if you can't handle heat, this dish is worth a try. This dish is usually plated in a port, so even the plating was correct. The port was full of beef and the flavor was in every bite of the meat. Very delicious. The only problem with this dish though is that it was too meaty. It would be nice if they could replace some meat with vegetables such as potatoes in the future. But overall, it was another excellent dish.
The Woomera capital of Horsham is ideally placed for excursions into the Little Desert National Park to the west and the majestic Grampians to the southeast. On the far right-hand side of the train, you begin to see the Grampians National Park, which covers more than 170,000 hectares at the western end of Victoria's Great Dividing Range. The park encompasses the Sarah, Victoria, Mount Difficult and Mount William ranges, with their towering sandstone peaks. Within the national park, you'll find a diverse collection of plants, animals, walking tracks, waterfalls, and rich Aboriginal culture.
While having my lunch, the train arrived at Horsham, which is 80 minutes northwest of Stawell. Next stop, Dimboola. Dimboola was the terminus for V-Line services from Southern Cross Station until 1993. Pacific National had a depot at Dimboola Station. A driver change occurred at this stop.
Small country town which exists largely on wheat and sheep and is also home to the Lover Duck Hatchery, which employs over 200 people. You'll notice after we leave the station, on the right is a tall old wheat silo. This particular silo in Nhill was constructed in the early 1920s and is capable of holding 135,000 bushels of wheat. It is also one of the oldest and largest of its kind in the Southern Hemisphere.
Nhill was the last station we stopped in Victoria. It's also the halfway point between Melbourne and Adelaide. After clearing my lunch plate, a dessert was served. Today's dessert was a mango macadamia cheesecake. The cake had three layers, a chocolate base, cheesecake in the middle, and mango-flavored cheesecake on top, with macadamia pieces and chocolate syrup toppings. It is a great dessert to neutralize my breath after having a meaty curry dish. Serviceton is a railway town, lies on the Victorian side of the Victoria-South Australia border. This town is a reminder of the importance of state borders before Federation and of a society where trains were the most efficient form of transport. The station was also a customs house before Federation to ensure duty was paid for goods taken across the state border. After Federation, the station was still being used to exchange crew and locomotives. By 1952, diesel had replaced steam on the railway line. With faster trains, increased road haulage and decreased passenger numbers, the station was eventually closed in 1986. After passing the 463-kilometer sign, which is the distance between here and Melbourne, and another 687 meters further, we reached the actual state border. 313.210 kilometers and decreasing, as we entered South Australia, the distance mark now shows the distance between here and Adelaide. South Australia follows Australian Central Standard Time, which is 30 minutes behind Australian Eastern Standard Time. You can see the magical time travel moment on my phone. The first South Australian town that we blasted through was Wolseley. You can see the remains of the now closed Mount Gambier railway line curving in as we enter the town.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are roughly 10 minutes away from arriving at Bordertown. Bordertown lies 17 kilometres from the South Australian-Victorian border. It is where the two main routes between Adelaide and Melbourne, the Duke's Highway and the railway line cross Tatiara Creek. The town was established in 1852 when a direct route was being planned for the gold escorts from the Victorian goldfields to Adelaide. Bordertown is also the birthplace of Australia's longest-serving Labor Prime Minister, Mr. Bob Hawke. It's also home to a colony of albino kangaroos in the wildlife park. Our next stop today, folks, is Bordertown.
As we arrived at our first stop in South Australia, you can see the difference in the style of the station building. It is made of limestone instead of brick that we saw in many Victorian stations. When we leave Bordertown, you will notice that the country very rapidly becomes drier, more scrubby, and less arable.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Bordertown, which means we need to do a couple of things. We need to change our clocks and timepieces to come into line with Central Standard Time. So correct time on train now is 10 minutes past 2. And also, folks, now that we have gone through Bordertown, it is no longer mandatory to wear face masks on our train. So you're very welcome to take your masks off. You're very welcome to keep them on also.
Just like the landscape outside, my throat was also a bit dry, so I headed to Cafe 828 to get a sparkling Pinot Chardonnay. But they turned out to be very popular and were sold out after lunch, so I bought a bottle of sparkling Merlot instead. The 200ml wine is bottled in a delicate mini wine bottle. The staff gave me a plastic wine glass for me to pour the drink. The train is very bumpy. Make sure you use both hands to pour the wine, otherwise you'd end up like me. Between Bordertown and Murray Bridge, the track is pretty much parallel to the A8 Dukes Highway. We passed through some small towns such as Keith, Tintinara and Coolnalpyn. Unfortunately, most stations on the Adelaide-Wolseley line were demolished. It can only be seen in the passing loops that this was once a railway station.
So Mark will come through, then I'll follow through as well. Let us know if you just want a tea, coffee, orange juice or a water. And let us know if you want the coconut cherry slice or the biscuits and cheese. Thank you.
Good choice. Okay.
When we passed through Tailand Bend, an afternoon tea was served. I picked the coconut cherry slice with a cup of orange juice.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we are fastly approaching Murray Bridge, which has been a significant place in overland transportation as it crosses the mighty Murray River. Originally called Edward's Crossing, Murray Bridge was a major port for the paddle boats that traversed the Murray during the early years. Shortly, we will cross Australia's biggest and most famous river. And on the right-hand side of the train as we cross, you'll still be able to see the very first bridge ever built across the Murray. Constructed in 1879, it carried rail, pedestrian and stock traffic, and is still in use today. As years went by, more and more traffic wanted to use the bridge, as well as over 15 trains a day. The rail bridge you'll be crossing the Murray today was opened in 1925. Gentlemen, that was Murray Bridge, our final stop before reaching Adelaide tonight. Now, we do have an anticipated time of arrival to Adelaide of 5 minutes past six, but I think we're going to do a little bit better tonight. We're going to be closer to quarter to six, possibly. I'm going to be closer to that.
After departing Murray Bridge, the landscape changed dramatically. Instead of the flat and dry countryside, it got hiller and wetter. For the next 65 kilometers, we were climbing almost continuously and the track were winding back and forth through the hills. Mount Barker Junction Station was formerly the junction for a railway line that ran from Adelaide down to Goolwa. This line was closed after the main line that we are travelling on converted from broad gauge to standard gauge in 1995, leaving the broad gauge branch line isolated. However, not all was lost. There is a heritage steam and a diesel train that travel from Goolwa to Victor Harbour and Goolwa to Mount Barker on a regular basis. Finally, at Mount Lofty, we reached the summit and started descending into the city. Belair Station is the terminus of Adelaide Metro's Belair Line. This is where Adelaide suburbs nominally commence. From here on, we ran parallel to the broad gauge suburban railway Belair Line.
Ladies and gentlemen, the drivers have done really well. We're only around about just over 10 minutes away from arriving at Adelaide Parkland Terminal. Adelaide is known as the festival state, particularly in March, where thousands gather for music, theatre, WOMAD and fringe events. The city is bustling with culture, pristine beaches and world-famous wineries. We will be arriving at Adelaide Parklands Terminal, which is situated 10 minutes from the CBD. Note that this is not the railway station located in the city. There is no public transport at the terminal, but we have phoned ahead for taxis for your convenience. On behalf of Journey Beyond, myself, Charlie, Jenny, Meg and Mark, we'd like to thank you for travelling with us and we look forward to welcoming you back in the near future.
Today's journey from Melbourne to Adelaide took 10 hours and 15 minutes. The train arrived at Adelaide 15 minutes ahead of schedule. The Overland used to be a busy commuter train and served as the fastest and most efficient way to travel between Melbourne and Adelaide. Nowadays, with Rex Airlines recently joining Melbourne to Adelaide route, flying between the two cities is significantly cheaper and way faster than catching this train. The A8 Western Highway in Victoria and Dukes Highway in South Australia made driving the faster option for travelling between regional towns. Hence, the Overland service became less and less popular over the last few decades. Nonetheless, the service that I experienced today was excellent. The red premium seat was very comfortable, the legroom was spacious, the three meals I had were very delicious. I've driven from Melbourne to Adelaide with my girlfriend in December 2020. Adding the breaks we had, it took us about the same time as the train took to travel between the two cities. Yet, the train is more relaxing and more enjoyable. So my conclusion is that flying is the best, but if you don't want to fly, then catching this train is better than driving. If you are a train enthusiast and would like to experience luxury train travel in Australia, the Overland is a good way to have a taste of what Journey Beyond has to offer, as the ticket on this train is way more affordable than other services that they run. Thank you so much for watching. It took me a lot of effort to edit this video. If you find it interesting, please leave a like and subscribe to my channel for more exciting train and flight reviews in the future. I'll see you guys in my next video.